Hello and welcome to the Commander's Quarters. I'm your host, Mitch. Glad to have you here. If this is your first time, let me give you a quick rundown on what we're all about. Here on the Commander's Quarters, we build fun and inexpensive focused commander decks. A focused commander deck is more tuned than a casual deck, but not quite to the level of a competitive or optimized deck. This episode is going to be a special one, though, where we exclude the price of the commander. With a $25 budget, it's pretty much impossible to build with some commanders without doing so. Also, there are times when you can just open a commander in a pack, or you just trade for them because you really want to build around them. So for those of you who have been asking for it, here's another price-excluded commander episode. Our budget is still going to be $25, but again, it's going to be $25 for 99 cards since we aren't counting the commander in that cost. Prices are powered by this channel's sponsor, TCG Player. And before we get started today, make sure you subscribe to the channel so that you can stay up to date on the latest Commander's Quarters videos. Today's commander is going to be Nicol Bolas the Ravager. He's a 4-4 flying Elder Dragon that costs 1 blue-black-red. He has, when he enters the battlefield, each opponent discards a card. He also has an ability where at sorcery speed you can pay 4 blue-black-red and exile him and return him to the battlefield transformed. He transforms into the Planeswalker Nicol Bolas the Arisen. His plus 2 is going to be draw 2 cards. His minus 3 is that he deals 10 damage to target creature or planeswalker. His minus 4 is put target creature or planeswalker card from a graveyard onto the battlefield under your control. And his minus 12 is exile all cards but the bottom card of target player's library. Now while this planeswalker side is quite powerful, we can't count on it to win us the game. So with this deck, we're mostly going to focus on the Ravager side of the card. And specifically, we're going to focus on that enter the battlefield trigger that makes each opponent discard a card. If we can abuse this effect, we can really set our opponents back. So what's our strategy for this deck? Well, we're going to utilize enter the battlefield effects to control the board and hand sizes. Not only are we going to abuse our commander's enter the battlefield effect, but also other creatures too. So how do we win with this deck? Well, we're going to win through discard damage, or if we have to, we can flip Nicol Bolas to finish them off. So there are plenty of cards that negatively impact our opponents for either discarding cards or for having a low hand size. And if we really have the game under control, we can flip our commander and then use his abilities to win. As with all Commander's Quarters deck techs, I'm going to take you through 10 tactics that show you how the deck works and how you're going to win with it. Let's go into tactic number 1, rock and roll. Since we don't have access to green with this deck, Wayfarer's Bauble is a fantastic include. All we have to do is pay 2 and sacrifice it, we can go search our library for a basic land and put into play tapped. Then we're running Sky, Charcoal, and Fire Diamond, each of which costs 2, enter the battlefield tapped, and can tap for one of our colors. And then we're running each of our signets, which include Dimir, Izzet, and Rakdos. Each costs 2, we can pay 1 and then tap them, and they add their guild's colors to our mana pool. Sphere of the Suns enters the battlefield tapped, it can tap for any color 3 times. And finally we've got Mindstone, which can either tap for a colorless, or we can pay 1 to tap and sacrifice it to draw a card. This not only comes in huge early in the game by helping us ramp, but it can also help us out late game by drawing us that card. With a 3-color deck, it's not only important to ramp, but also to fix our mana. And our mana rocks help us either do one or both of those. So after we ramp and fix, what kind of cards are we going to cast? Let's look at some in tactic number 2, the usual way. So again, the focus of this deck is to get creatures in play that have good enter the battlefield effects and then to abuse those effects. And perhaps the first creature that we should be getting out first is our commander, since it makes our opponents discard a card. Especially early on, this can really set back our opponents and help upset their game plan. So after we have our commander in play, we're going to cast things like Essence Flux and Siren's Ruse. Both of them are going to exile Nicol Bolas and bring him back into play under our control. First of all, this can help us save him from any targeted removal. But more importantly, it gets that enter the battlefield trigger to happen again. So our opponents will have to discard another card and set them back even further. Release to the Wind is a very similar effect, but it's not quite the same. It's going to let us exile any target non-land permanent, and for as long as that card remains exiled, its owner can cast it without paying its mana cost. So if we really want to, we can target our opponent's stuff with this, but most of the time we're going to be targeting our own. This can not only save Nicol Bolas from any targeted removal, but it can also save him from board wipes. And then when we want to, we can cast him again without paying his mana cost. Just keep in mind though that we can only cast him still during our main phases. We're also going to be running cards like Ghostly Flicker, Displace, and Illusionist Stratagem. Each of these cards is going to let us exile up to 2 creatures that we control and then return them back to the battlefield under our control. And on top of that, Illusionist Stratagem is going to let us draw a card, but it does cost 1 more. Remember that with this deck, it's not just Nicol Bolas that has a good enter the battlefield effect, but we're running others as well. So these cards provide us with a ton of value depending on what creatures we have in play. Then we're running Voidwalk, which is going to be a flicker effect rather than a blink effect. A flicker effect is when we exile a creature and then it comes back at the end step, whereas a blink effect means that we exile the creature and it comes back immediately. On top of flickering a creature though, Voidwalk has Cipher on it. So when we cast Voidwalk, we can exile it and then encode it on one of our creatures that we control. Whenever that creature deals combat damage to a player, we get to cast Voidwalk again for free. This card can provide us a ton of value depending on what creatures we have in play. Next up is going to be Voyager's Staff, which is an artifact that costs 1. And at any time, we can pay 2 to sacrifice it to flicker a creature. This is just a really good utility card to have on the field that can help us out in a variety of circumstances. And then finally, we've got Deadeye Navigator. It's a 5/5 that has soul bond, and as long as it's paired with another creature, each of those creatures has, pay one in a blue, exile this creature, and return to the battlefield under your control. So if we pair this guy with Nicol Bolas, we only have to pay one in a blue to make all of our opponents discard a card. This is a great way to help us decimate our opponent's hands. Now these cards are the more straightforward way that we either flicker or bounce our creatures to abuse our enter the battlefield effects. But there are other ways to do it as well, so let's look at some of those in tactic number 3, a roundabout way. By paying 2 and tapping Synod Sanctum, we can exile target permanent that we control. And then at any time we can pay 2 to sacrifice it and return all cards exiled with Synod Sanctum to the battlefield under our control. And then Cold Storage is very similar to this, but it costs us 3 to exile a creature that we control. It does have the benefit though that we can sacrifice it for free in order to put all those creatures back into play. So with Synod Sanctum and Cold Storage, we can get multiple Enter the Battlefield effects by exiling multiple creatures. Synod Sanctum is a little bit slower since we can only do it once per turn, and we have to be careful to make sure that we have 2 extra mana available in case someone tries to destroy it at any time. Because if either of these are destroyed and we can't sacrifice them, then we lose all the cards that were exiled by them. But again, these cards can help not only protect our creatures from board wipes, but they can also give us some really explosive turns by giving us a ton of Enter the Battlefield effects all at once. Another sneaky way to get an extra Enter the Battlefield effect is going to be something like Supernatural Stamina. Supernatural Stamina is going to give one of our creatures +2/+0 until the end of the turn, and when that creature dies, we return it back to the battlefield tapped under our control. Undying Evil is very similar in that it's going to give that creature undying until the end of the turn. Both of these are great responses to either targeted removal or to a board wipe, and we get an extra benefit out of it. Next up is going to be Twin Flame, which will let us create a temporary copy of one of our creatures. This token's going to have haste, and we have to exile at the beginning of our next end step, but we really just want the Enter the Battlefield trigger off of this. And if we have extra mana, it does have Strive for 2 and a red, so we can cast it to target more than one creature. Because of the legendary rule, we will lose that token if we target someone like Nicol Bolas, but again, we just really care about that Enter the Battlefield effect. Then there's Mirror Image, which is a creature that when it comes into play, it becomes a copy of any creature we control. And then Cackling Counterpart is going to create a token that's a copy of any creature we control, and it has Flashback for 5 blue-blue. Again, the important thing out of all of these ways to copy creatures is that we're getting more Enter the Battlefield effects. Speaking of copying creatures, let's go on to Flame Shadow Conjuring and Minion Reflector. Flame Shadow Conjuring is an enchantment that will let us pay red whenever a non-token creature comes into play, and we get to create a copy of that. That token's going to gain haste, and we have to exile at the beginning of our next end step, but again, we get that Enter the Battlefield trigger, which is the important part. Minion Reflector is an artifact that does pretty much the exact same thing, but we have to pay 2 instead of that red. Both of these are great ways that can combine with our flickering and blink effects to get additional Enter the Battlefield triggers. Alright, so we've gone through a lot of ways to abuse those Enter the Battlefield triggers. But other than Bolas' trigger, what other triggers are we going to be needing in this deck? Let's go through some of them now in tactic number 4, Beautiful Drawings. Merfolk Traders, Vildalion Merchant, and Owl Familiar are all pretty much the exact same card. When they enter the battlefield, we get to draw a card and then discard a card. Now, while looting technically isn't card advantage, it helps us dig through our deck to find the cards that we need. And again, since these are Enter the Battlefield effects, we can loot multiple times with these cards. Next up, we've got Champion of Wits, which is going to draw us 2 cards, and then we have to discard 2 cards. On top of that, if it ever dies, we can eternalize it by paying 5 blue-blue, and then we'll be able to draw 4 cards and discard 2. Then we've got Dusk Legion Zealot, Merchant of Secrets, and Sky Scanner, each of which will draw us a card when they come into play. Dusk Legion Zealot does cost 1 less than the other 2, but it is going to make us lose 1 life when it comes into play. This is going to be well worth it, though, for drawing that card. And then we've got our best Enter the Battlefield draw ability with Riverwise Augur. When it enters the battlefield, we get to draw 3 cards and then put 2 cards from our hand on top of our library in any order. So anytime that we can either flicker or blink this guy, we pretty much get a brainstorm. But the major source of draw in this deck is mostly going to be coming from our next card. Guest Grimoire is an artifact that has whenever an opponent discards a card from his or her hand, we draw a card. Again, with this deck, we're going to be blinking and flickering Nicol Bolas a ton, making our opponents discard a ton of cards. If each of our opponents discards a card, we draw 3 cards. This card can set us so far ahead of our opponents by drawing us into more ways to flicker and blink Bolas. But we can't just count on Nicol Bolas to do all the dirty work for us, we need some cards that have similar effects. So let's go on to tactic number 5, Like Father, Like Son. Burglar Rat, Liliana Spectre, and Cackling Fiend each have the exact same Enter the Battlefield effect that Nicol Bolas does. When they come into play, each opponent has to discard a card. So if Bolas is in play and we have ways to flicker both of them, our opponents are going to be discarding 2 cards at a time. They're also a great backup plan in case Nicol Bolas dies too many times. And Burglar Rat and Liliana Spectre can even get out earlier than Bolas, so they can really help us set our opponents back before Bolas even comes into play. Now these are some great Enter the Battlefield effects, but let's go through some others in tactic number 6, Player 2 has entered. Possessed Scab is a fantastic addition to this deck. When it enters the battlefield, we get to return either an instant, sorcery, or creature card from our graveyard to our hand. Now this can either be one of our flicker or blink effects, or it can be one of our great enter the battlefield effects. This card is especially effective when we have something like Displace in our hand that blinks two of our creatures. With Displace, for only 3 mana we can blink Possess Scab and another creature continuously since Possess Scab can get us that card back. And then we've got Mana War, Exclusion Mage, and Aether Adept, each of which pretty much do the exact same thing. When they enter the battlefield, they're going to return target creature to its owner's hand. Now, Exclusion Mage does have a restriction where it only applies to opponent's creatures, but most of the time we're going to be targeting our opponent's creatures with these guys anyway. However, if we do bounce one of our creatures back with either Mana War or Aether Adept, we get their Enter the Battlefield triggers again when we cast them. Next up is Sidraxis Alchemist, which when it comes into play, if we control a blue permanent, we get to return target non-land permanent to its owner's hand. That blue permanent restriction really isn't that big of a deal since the majority of our permanents in this deck are blue, including our commander. And when this guy comes into play, we get to bounce any non-land permanent, which is huge. So if an opponent has an artifact or enchantment that's really hurting us, we can bounce it back to their hand. And the best part of these bounce effects is that they really work well with our discarding effects too. There are many times where we can bounce something back to our opponent's hand and it will be the only card in their hand. Then we can make them discard it and it effectively gets rid of that threat for us. Finally, we've got Ravenous Chupacabra and Necrotal. Both have pretty much the exact same enter the battlefield effect. When they come into play, we get to destroy a creature. Necrotal does have the restriction that it can't be an artifact or black creature, but again, it's still a very good effect. These are just great, repeatable ways for this deck to remove our opponent's best creatures. We do have some other more flexible ways to deal with our opponent's threats and to save some of our creatures as well. Let's go through them in tactic number 7, back so soon. Aether Spellbomb is an artifact that we can pay a blue to sacrifice it to return target creature to its owner's hand. We can also pay one of any color to sacrifice it to draw a card. This is a very flexible card for this deck. This either lets us save one of our creatures from danger or bounce one of our opponent's threats. And if we're in a real pinch, we can sacrifice it to draw a card. Then there's Crystal Shard, which is a fantastic card for this deck. It's an artifact that we can tap it to return target creature to its owner's hand unless its controller pays 1. In a pinch, we can tap this to return any of our creatures to our hand for free. This is very helpful when we either want to save one of our creatures, or if we just want to get that Enter the Battlefield trigger again. And if one of our opponents isn't paying attention and taps out, we can bounce any of their creatures back to their hand too. Speaking of bouncing though, let's go through some cards that do this in an even bigger way. It's time to go on to tactic number 8, let's bounce. Again, by getting our cards back into our opponent's hands, we can make them discard them. This not only helps us get rid of some of our opponent's threats, but it also helps us damage them with certain cards in play. Aether Gale is a sorcery that's going to let us return 6 target non-land permanents to their owner's hands. This card is great at letting us pick and choose what we need to get rid of. But sometimes we just need everything to reset, so we cast something like Devastation Tide. Devastation Tide is going to return all non-land permanents to their owner's hands. And on top of that, it has a miracle cost for 1 and a blue, so we can cast it for cheap if we draw it as our first card in a turn. And now finally, we've gotten to our Golden Pig of the deck, which again is the number 1 card out of the 99. Noetic Scales is an artifact that has, at the beginning of each player's upkeep, return to its owner's hand each creature that player controls with power greater than the number of cards in their hand. This card can be devastating against our opponents with this deck. Again, we are going to be making our opponents discard a ton of cards. And there are plenty of times when our opponents won't have any cards in their hand. With Noetic Scales in play, it will be pretty much impossible for any of our opponents to keep any of their creatures on the board. This not only helps us remove all of our opponent's threats, but it also gives us the opportunity to force them to discard those cards. And since the majority of our creatures have very low power, we're going to get to keep those creatures on the board. And even when we do have to bounce a creature back to our hand, it's only usually a benefit to us since we have those Enter the Battlefield abilities. So this card doesn't just help us defensively, but it also helps us offensively too. Noetic Scales does so much work for this deck, and that's why it's the Golden Pig of the deck. There are some other really great cards in this deck though that help us deal with our opponent's threats too. Let's go through some of them now in tactic number 9, Mischief Managed. Whelming Wave is pretty much going to return every single creature back to their owner's hands. It doesn't affect Krakens, Leviathan, Octopuses, or Serpents, but again, the majority of creatures aren't those types. Not only does this help us reset the board, but it also helps us get our Enter the Battlefield effects again. Evacuation is even better because we can cast it at instant speed and it does return all creatures back to their owner's hands. Next up, we've got Crux of Fate, and pretty much every single time we cast it, we're going to choose to destroy all non-dragon creatures. This will help us keep our commander on the board while decimating our opponent's boards. Then there's Necromantic Selection, which does double duty for us. Not only does it destroy all creatures, but we can return a creature put into a graveyard this way to the battlefield under our control. So not only do we blow up the board, but we can also get one of our Enter the Battlefield triggers again off of this. Next up is the Eldest Reborn, which is a saga. With its first lore counter, each opponent has to sacrifice a creature or planeswalker. Its second lore counter is going to make each opponent discard a card. And then its third lore counter is going to let us put target creature or planeswalker card from a graveyard onto the battlefield under our control. So this card does triple duty for us. It deals with cards in play, it deals with cards in our opponent's hands, and it's going to give us some additional value by giving us one of those cards. Finally, we're going to be running some counter spells with Negate and Familiar's Ruse. Negate will let us counter a non-creature spell, whereas Familiar's Ruse can counter any spell. However, with Familiar's Ruse, we also have to return a creature back to our hand in order to cast it. This is actually a benefit to us, though. Since our creatures have a lot of great enter the battlefield effects, we'll get that effect again once we cast them. Alright, so we've talked a lot about controlling the board and our opponent's hand sizes, but how do we finish our opponents off? Let's see how we do it in tactic number 10, Painful Losses. Wheel of Torture, Shrieking Affliction, and Skullcage will each damage our opponents depending on how many cards they have in their hand. Wheel of Torture has, at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, Wheel of Torture deals X damage to that player, where X is 3 minus the number of cards in their hand. Again, this deck is great at completely taking out opponents' hands, so if they have 0 cards in their hand, they're going to take 3 damage each turn. Shrieking Affliction is very similar in that it has, at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, if that player has 1 or fewer cards in their hand, he or she loses 3 life. Again, it's not too hard for this deck to take our opponents down to 1 or 2 cards, so they're going to be taking a ton of damage. And then Skullcage is going to hurt them in a different way. At the beginning of our opponent's upkeeps, unless they have exactly 3 or 4 cards in their hand, Skullcage is going to deal 2 damage to them. All of these effects really add up, especially when multiple are on the field. But we get the best of these effects with Quest for the Nihil Stone. It's an enchantment that has, whenever an opponent discards a card, we get to put a quest counter on it. And as long as there are 2 or more quest counters on it, at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, if they don't have any cards in their hand, they lose 5 life. It is very easy for us to get those counters on this card. Just by casting our commander once, we get 3 counters. And as long as we can keep our opponents at 0 cards in their hand, 5 life is a lot to lose each turn. And if they do have cards in their hand and we have ways to make them discard them, we can also damage them. Megrim and Raider's Wake are both enchantments with the same effect. Whenever an opponent discards a card, they lose 2 life. On top of that, Raider's Wake has an additional ability. At the beginning of our end step, if we attacked with a creature this turn, we're going to get to make one of our opponents discard a card. This deck is brutal and unforgiving. Our opponents are in trouble when they have cards in their hand, and they're in trouble when they don't have cards in their hand. And if we're in enough control of the game, we can just transform Nicol Bolas to destroy our opponents. But now that we've gone through the cards that help us win, let's go through the cards that help make this deck work. It's time to go on to the mana base. We're going to be running 35 lands in this deck, including Crumbling Necropolis. It enters the battlefield tapped. It can tap for any of our colors. Then we're running Dimir Guildgate, Salt Marsh, Dismal Backwater, and Jawar Isle Refuge. Each of them enter the battlefield tapped. It can tap for either a blue or a black. On top of that, Dismal Backwater and Jawar Isle Refuge will gain us 1 life when they come into play. Then we're running Highland Lake, Izzet Guildgate, and Swiftwater Cliffs. Each of them enter the battlefield tapped and tap for blue or red. Swiftwater Cliffs will even gain us a life when it comes into play. Finally, we've got Bloodfell Caves and Akuam Refuge, each of which enter the battlefield tapped, tap for either a black or red, and they gain us a life when they come into play. Next up is Dimir Aqueduct, which when it enters the battlefield, it enters tapped, and we're going to have to return a land we control back to our hand. It does have the added benefit, though, of being able to tap for a blue and a black. Izzet Boilerworks does the exact same thing, but it can tap for a blue and a red. Then we've got Crypt of the Eternals, which will gain us 1 life when it comes into play, and it can tap for a colorless. On top of that, it can help us filter our mana. By paying 1 into it, we can tap it for any of our colors. Then there's Evolving Wilds and Terramorphic Expanse, both of which we can sacrifice to search our library for a basic land and put into play tapped. Next up is Rocky Tar Pit, which will enter the battlefield tapped. We can tap to sacrifice Rocky Tar Pit and search our library for a swamp or a mountain and it comes into play untapped. Finally, we're running 3 of the Panoramas, including Grixis, Esper, and Jund. Each of them can tap for a colorless, and Grixis can search for any of our basic lands by paying 1 to tap and sacrifice it. Esper and Jund do the exact same thing, but they can only search for 1 of 2 of our basic lands. And finally, we're going to be running 16 basic lands, including 9 islands, 5 swamps, and 2 mountains. Now that we've gone through every single card in this deck, though, let's do a quick price check. A quick reminder that each of our deck costs are calculated using TCG Player Optimization, optimizing with even heavily played and damaged cards because those cards need a home too. The average Nicol Bolas the Ravager EDH rec deck is going to set you back $286.11. Let's see how we compare to that. Our deck is going to be much more affordable, coming in at just $24.96. A quick reminder that these costs do not include the commander cost. All of our Commander's Quarters decks are built to be tuned and optimized within our $25 budget. But being built in a budget, there are always ways that we can improve on them. Let's go through our reasonable upgrades to see what some of those ways just might be. First up, we've got Panharmonicon, which comes in at $3.99. Panharmonicon is an artifact that costs 4 and it has, if an artifact or creature entering the battlefield causes a triggered ability of a permanent you control to trigger, that ability triggers an additional time. Basically, this card would just double up every single one of our enter the battlefield effects. This card would be so good in the deck that it might even be better than the Golden Pig if you put it in. Then there's Conjurer's Closet, which comes in at $2.49. Conjurer's Closet is an artifact that costs 5 and it says, at the beginning of your end step, you may exile target creature you control and then return that card to the battlefield under your control. This card just basically gives us a free enter the battlefield effect for any of our creatures. Then there's Waste Knot, which costs $4.22. Waste Knot is an enchantment that costs 1 and a black. It says, whenever an opponent discards a creature card, create a 2-2 black zombie creature token. Whenever an opponent discards a land card, add black-black to your mana pool. And whenever an opponent discards a non-creature, non-land card, draw a card. This card provides us with a ton of value whenever we force our opponents to discard cards. Next up is Liliana's Caress, which comes in at $3.42. Liliana's Caress is an enchantment that costs 1 and a black, and it says, whenever an opponent discards a card, that player loses 2 life. This card is the exact same as Megrim, but it costs 1 less. Then there's Bloodchief Ascension, which is $8.78. Bloodchief Ascension is an enchantment that costs a black. It has, at the beginning of each end step, if an opponent lost 2 or more life this turn, you may put a quest counter on Bloodchief Ascension. Whenever a card is put into an opponent's graveyard from anywhere, if Bloodchief Ascension has 3 or more quest counters on it, you may have that player lose 2 life. If you do, you gain 2 life. It's very easy for us to get 3 counters on this card, and making our opponents lose 2 life whenever one of their cards gets put into a graveyard from anywhere is huge. And the life gain can also help us in a lot of situations too. Finally, we've got Pauper's Cage, which comes in at $1.77. Pauper's Cage is an artifact that costs 3. It has, at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, if that player has 2 or fewer cards in hand, Pauper's Cage deals 2 damage to that player. This is just another great way to punish our opponents for not having cards in their hand. And with that, the show is coming to a close, but I really just want to hear about what you guys think about this deck, so why don't you let me know in the comments below. When you're buying decks like this one, or just individual cards, make sure you're using that TCG Player link in the description below. Not only will you get great prices on TCG Player, but by buying from them, you're going to be supporting this show because they sponsor us. And make sure you're following us on both Twitter and Facebook so that you can get early hints on who the next commander just might be. Links to the Commander's Quarters Twitter and Facebook can be found in the description below as well. Also in the description below is a link to the Commander's Quarters Patreon page, and I just want to say a quick thank you to the patrons who have subscribed so far. There are many benefits to being a patron of the Commander's Quarters, including being able to vote on future commanders for deck techs. There's even a new general level tier where you can get your own personalized deck tech dedicated to you. If you enjoyed this episode, make sure you like it and subscribe to the channel. And make sure you check out our other videos on budget deck techs and budget staples. Alright, that's all from me today. Thanks again, and have a good one.